I think the book has a funny way of talking to me. Every time I read it, I find something new. Some story that seemed to be previously hidden away, as if the pages are just rooms whose inhabitants walk freely between them. When I opened the book, I'd already seen a hint of the story within, although I hadn't quite worked that out yet. A couple of days ago, I'd seen an article, read the headline, and then scrolled on, something about a Scottish festival in the Highlands, an old, archaic festival only held by one village that celebrates something to do with the full moon. Like I said, I didn't pay much attention. Although, I wish I had now, because after reading this story, I tried to find it again, and no matter how hard I tried, I couldn't find the article. I don't believe it's gone completely. I just think it must have sunk back into the muck. Maybe you'll know what I'm talking about. If you do, please let me know. Regardless, here's the story I found in the book this morning. Kelpie, or Why You Should Never Trust a Man in the Moonlight. He knew, the first time he saw her, that they were bound together. He knew in the same way you know about a bruise or an open wound. He knew and said nothing. Instead, he watched in silence as she left a trail of wet footprints on the bone-dry pavement and the seaweed glistened in her hair. He was just a boy then and would not see her properly again until he was almost a man. He would see parts of her in his dreams. And now and again, he'd think that he saw her in the village center, picking up on that familiar smell, driftwood and mud, and spying wet footprints on the stone. He would wait for her sometimes, and when, once a year, the town would almost double in population to celebrate the first full moon after the winter solstice, he would ignore the dozens of young women and men who streamed in, who drank cheap beer and sang in the streets, who would call to him to come and join when they saw him, who were drunk and young and only wanted company. It was Martin who found him a few weeks after his 18th birthday, alone. Martin sprawled beside him, stinking of whiskey and oil, his hands calloused and massive, and looked to him, eyes glazed. "Not joining the fun, boy." He wanted to correct Martin, to tell him that he was a man now, not a boy, but he stayed silent. He stayed silent and glared. "Lots of pretty girls." A hiccup. "Boys too, if that's your thing." He spoke up. It was the first time he would ever speak about her, and he was terrified for a moment that in actually putting it into words, he would realize how insane it all was. And Martin would laugh at him, call him crazy, and the whole thing would crash down around his ears. "A girl." Martin grunted, a noise that said, "Go on." I've only seen her once." At the sound of this fact, Martin sat up, rested his elbow on his knees. His face gained a sudden seriousness that put years on him and cut through the alcohol-induced glaze. Martin looked at him, long and hard, as if working out some elaborate and dangerous puzzle. "What did she look like, this girl?" He did not want to admit what he'd seen, didn't want to be exposed as a fool, laughed out of town by a man three times his age. Martin passed him the bottle in silence, waiting. He realized then, taking a sip and wincing, that this was the only time Martin had ever treated him as an equal, as a man, and not a boy, and that Martin was really listening, and so he told the truth. He told the truth about the seaweed in her hair and the trail of wet footprints, and that he knew they were bound together. Martin stayed silent, biting his lower lip, and rubbing the graying stubble on his jaw. He could suddenly see Martin's age, the bags under his eyes, the slouch in his posture, the gnarled fingers. And something else, a gravity that lay behind Martin's jolly exterior, a sense that whatever they were sharing now was not only real, but important. Martin asked him how he knew they were bound together. He said he knew, the same way you know about a bruise or an open wound. Martin nodded. Right answer. The movement was more towards himself than anything else, but while he stood up, he beckoned the boy to follow. They retrieved a rabbit from a large hutch in the back of Martin's garden first, picking one that was huge and gray, and that went limp with fear when they shone a torch in its face. They walked in silence away from the village for an hour, perhaps more, until they took a route through a thin strip of woods. They emerged in the moonlight. Only the shore of a vast and still lake. The moonlight illuminated the stretch of shore around them, and he could see the light like a white tongue upon the lake's surface. They were surrounded by silence, a silence that seemed to be a question as opposed to a response, as if it was asking them, "What now?" Martin chose to answer. He turned and spoke softly but firmly. You do not stay in the water for long. You put the prey maybe 2-3 feet out at most. Then you sit by the shore and wait. Under no circumstances do you get in the lake. This is the closest you'll ever get. He did not entirely understand, but the tone had shifted in Martin's voice. These were less like instructions and more like commandments. Martin's tone reminded him of the vicar in church when he spoke about fire and brimstone. It was the same grave certainty, the same notes of apprehension and awe. Martin stuck a small needle in the rabbit and handed it to him. He followed Martin's instructions to the letter and pushed the rabbit out. The thing had just enough energy to thrash as it half sank. He waited. The ripples the rabbit made seemed to attract something larger, something that moved from the center of the lake, underwater, only just disturbing the surface, a swell that grew and grew as it approached the rabbit. He almost couldn't believe his eyes. Except, dear reader, he could. Because he'd known this all along, the same way you know about a broken bone. A dark horse came from the depths, black and huge, and dripping with lake water, with eyes as red as embers, a horse that had weeds for a mane and sharp teeth that glinted in the light. The horse seemed to form itself from the water instead of emerging from under it. As if its very DNA was liquid, and it swallowed the rabbit in 2 bites. There was the crunch of bone and the wet sound of the beast swallowing. And then, as if the horse form was water, the horse melted away and revealed the girl, pale and naked in the moonlight, her mouth and chin wet with the blood of the rabbit. But she was a woman now, and when she looked at him, he ached like he'd never ached before, and every inch of her skin made him breathless, and try as he might, he couldn't take his eyes off her, and he knew he would do whatever it took to see her again. He watched her from the shore, studied her as she studied him. He knew he loved her, knew he always had. And I must make it clear at this point, dear reader, that she loved him. She, who was made from water and who had only been a horse thing a second ago, loved him. But she loved him the way wild beasts love, with teeth and claws and in the dark. When she finally slipped back into the water, he heard Martin speak up. In all honesty, he'd entirely forgotten Martin was there. But as Martin spoke, he could hear the words slur and shake and realize that Martin had been drinking the entire time. Martin warned him that a rabbit wouldn't work next time. Warned him that she'd be hungrier. He laughed and said he'd bring whatever it took, no matter if it was a deer or a goat or a cow. Martin said nothing. Stared ahead, looked to him, eyes wet with tears. He understood then. He knew what it would take and why it could not be said, and why Martin had made sure that he really loved her. From that day on, his life took two separate paths. He married young, perhaps to distract himself from her, or perhaps because he thought he should. They married in a village on the other side of the country, as far away from the lake as possible. But the lake and the horse and the girl lurked in his mind, like an itch he couldn't scratch. Every year, he'd return to the village, make excuses as to why he couldn't bring his wife, with his heart in his mouth. He'd use whatever he had to, old-fashioned dating sites, ads, and magazines. He would meet young men and drink with them, dance with them, eat with them, during the height of the festival before taking them to the lake. He would tell them he was going to show them something that would change their lives. And, in his own way, he was right. He did not enjoy it. If you'd have asked, he would have said he was a good man who was made to do bad things. I'll leave it up to you to decide. He knew vets and doctors, and it wasn't hard to create a solution, ketamine infused, just enough to render his victims able to move an inch, just enough to send those ripples into the center of the lake, ripples that he would watch with a dry mouth and his heart going so fast, it felt like it was vibrating. And without fail, she would come. She came first as the horse thing, the thing that he began to call Kelpie, a Scottish legend that he now knew was real in the way only myths can be, that would bare its teeth that grew larger year on year, with its black body glistening and huge in the moonlight, that would make short work of whatever he'd brought for it. That twitching body in the shallows. And then once it was full, her. The water would fall away, retreating like sea spray from cliff face, and it would reveal her, naked and pale in the moonlight, weeds in her hair, and those eyes that would lock with his. The light cast strange shadows over her body, over her thighs and stomach and arms, and he would watch with bated breath as she walked closer and closer to shore. He would watch her chest rise and fall as she took deep breaths, perhaps the only breath she would take each year, he did not know, and watch as the blood mixed with water, dark and then clear, and then joined the lake. Those moments, just the two of them, separate but together, made it all worth it. At this point in the story, you would have every right to call him a murderer, or the worst kind of criminal, and I would be inclined to agree with you. The difficulty is, dear reader, that he cannot hear either of us. Even if he could, he would not have listened. He was alone with his love and his lust and that vast, still lake. His double life continued, pretty much unchanged, murderer and husband, until the birth of his first child. The birth was about a month before the festival, and he made his excuses in advance, how he'd be only gone for a night, and that it was important, and that he'd be back with both of them before they knew it. That night, the night of the festival, there was a storm. It was a storm so huge that the air seemed to crackle with static, and the rain lashed the soil in waves, and lightning forked in the distance. At this point, he would sometimes even forget their names, and simply drag them to the lake with offers of sex or drugs. This time, as he watched the twitching body out into the shallows and waited, he noticed that the lightning was growing closer. So close, in fact, that every time it struck the ground, it would illuminate the whole world in a blanket of light. This would last just long enough for him to see as far as the horizon, clear as day. And in these flashes of light that would break the sky only a second or two after the thunder, he saw something that changed him forever. Something that if he'd really thought about, he should have known all along. Along the shore of the lake, as far as he could see, were hundreds and hundreds of tiny figures, and in front of each of these tiny figures was a shape bobbing in the shallows. And as he saw her appear from the lake, the horse thing, the Kelpie, and he saw those eyes like embers, he saw the same scene happening hundreds and hundreds of times over along the shore of the lake, and he realized that he wasn't alone, and never had been, and that every man in the village was out tonight with their own offering, their own prey, and they were all feeding their own horse things, their own Kelpies, that they didn't own, that they couldn't touch, but only see, feeding the very lake itself. When she turned into a woman and squatted by the edge of the lake, he grew closer than he'd ever been, filled with a newfound courage, a courage found in the knowledge that he wasn't alone. Close enough to see things he'd never seen before, the slight webbing of her fingers and toes, the sharp hooks on the back of her feet. From then on, his life became easier. The festival still filled him with a strange sense of apprehension, but it was soothed by the knowing looks of the men of the village, the nods that said so much, and the way the men would slowly filter out from the bars and pubs and parks, all with a partner, headed towards the vast and still lake, with one thing on their minds. Years passed, and every year he'd shuffle a little closer to the water, a little closer to her. But his victims' faces all began to blur into one, and this blurred, vague face would keep him up at night. He'd hear it speaking in the static on the radio and watch its lips move in the mirror. Sometimes, when he hadn't slept, he would even see the blurred thing stretched across the face of his son. He was in his 40s when he decided he couldn't take it anymore. I don't know what drove him to it, and I'm not sure he did either. Perhaps the weight of what he'd done finally dawned on him. Perhaps it was an argument with his now ex-wife. Perhaps it was the knowledge that soon his son would discover the lake, one way or another, and he wasn't sure which was worse. His son crouched by the shore, holding a syringe and shaking with lust, or his son as a body, twitching and dead-eyed in the shallows. Whatever it was, that year he did not contact anymore. He did not reach out on any dating sites or addict forums or try and meet anyone at the bar. He attended the festival alone with a grim look in his eyes. The men of the village that he saw knew that look well and did not try and talk him out of it. He made the walk to the lake alone and stood by the shore for a while, breathing in the smell one last time. The smell of driftwood and mud. He took off his clothes, folded them into a small pile which he slipped under a fallen log. He took off his boots, his underwear, and stood naked in the moonlight. Then, he started to walk out into the lake. He loved her more than he could put into words, and that love weighed on him and pulled him deeper and deeper into the lake. I do not know what he was expecting. But she loved him too, and when she found him, she loved him the only way she knew how, with teeth and claws, and in the dark. And when his wife pleaded with a local policeman to check the lake, stating that this village was the last place he'd mentioned, and that she knew he walked to that lake even though he tried to hide it, she was met with silence. When his wife asked men in the town, men that ran the pubs and the bars, and who worked at the shops, the men who had wives and husbands and sons and daughters, the men who prayed at church and who taught at the school, the men who drank and swore and spat, the men who loved and laughed and cried. She was always met with the same stony silence. They knew where he was, the same way you know about a bruise or an open wound. I wish I could say I entirely believed this story. The fact that the festival occurs every year and every man in the village manages to bring someone for their kelpie just doesn't seem likely to me. Surely that amount of disappearances, so localized, would be noticed by someone. But then again, maybe the story isn't there to be believed, or maybe only parts of it are. I'm still figuring this book out, I suppose. I wonder if he's with her now, at the bottom of that vast and still lake, or if he died in the shallows, like the rest of them.